meaningful as possible. And we have Sanch, Borthakur is here. Hi, Sanch. And Rongmon, Bordoloi, are you here? Can you, yeah, there you are. You can go ahead and unmute if you like. And then Gwen, Rudie is here as well. Hi, Gwen. All right, so I have been looking at the Slack channel and I want to bring up the first subject, which was mentioned by Evan Schneider, but also one of the first things Todd mentioned, which is this idea of a cloudy versus a misty circumgalactic medium. And in particular, you know, Evan suggested that this might be a fun exercise for the workshop to clarify exactly what we mean by cloudy versus misty when we ask this question. Do observers and theorists mean the same thing? Do theorists and theorists mean the same thing? Which I think is funny. And I think the answer is probably not. But I want to take, since our panel is a panel of expert observers, I want to get people's point of view on, you know, how do you think about this? With the observational data, how are you defining this? Are you looking at kind of cloud lengths, line widths? Can you talk a little bit about the facets of the data that might actually be able to distinguish between, you know, a mist versus a cloud? And maybe some questions that you might pose to theorists.
Well, I'll just jump in real quickly. In my mind, the patchiness of whatever it is you're looking at is part of it.
Explain what you mean by patchiness.
Well, you can just think of the image I had from Max's paper at the beginning. On the one side, you had all these little, very small scale droplets. On the other side, there was more of a smooth, larger structure. And so that's a kind of an intuitive, I mean, to be honest, I'm just following the theorist's lead and trying to, you know, cloud shattering, what does that mean? Is it consistent with the data? But certainly with the Markarian 231 outflow, we needed to have some kind of patchiness so that the ultraviolet light could get through, and yet there was some sort of dusty outflow, which is where the broad absorption line features are imprinted on the data. I guess maybe the word misty sort of conveys what's in my mind, because, you know, it's a lot of droplets like a fog or something.
Maybe somebody else on the panel wants to weigh in on how you think about the structures.
So I can quickly share just one or two slides, which I think maybe bear on this question a little bit. So in some sense, this is similar to some of the things that Todd just showed. This is from my own work at High Redshift now. So we're looking at CGM absorption, 75 kiloparsecs within the virial radius of a high redshift sort of L star galaxy. And you can see the incredible complexity in the structure of these absorption lines. And I completely agree with what Todd said about spectral resolution and signal to noise really mattering for being able to disentangle both the very complex structure of these systems, but also the sort of multi-phase nature. You can see that the oxygen six looks completely different in structure from the somewhat lower ion phases. But I think in particular, when we're talking about cloud sizes, I would refer people back to Michael Rauch's early work that Todd mentioned. And it actually, one of the quasars in our sample is one of the quasars that Michael Rauch used to look at lensing. And so we can actually look directly in the CGM of this galaxy, if I can get my slides to advance. Let me show this again. All right, and so this is an example where we can actually look at 400 parsec scale resolution in the same CGM, and we can see,
we're not seeing what you're seeing. We're seeing your Slack and your email.
Okay. Pardon me. Thank you. Did that work? Perfect. Apologies. Okay, so if we look 400 parsecs away between these two different images of this quasar, what we can see now, the black spectrum behind it is one image and the red colored is the higher signal to noise, brighter image. And what we can see is actually the structure changes completely in these low ions. Oxygen six actually looks completely the same across these two lines of sight. And I think what that tells us is that these low ion phases, just like Michael had concluded in his papers around in the sort of early 2000s, late 1990s, is that, you know, these structures are very, very small. Whether that makes them a mist or a cloud, I think maybe, like, unless we actually ascribe real physical meaning to that, like Evan, I think, was talking about shattering. I mean, I think that that's semantics, unless we actually describe some, like, physical underlying concept of where these clouds, how these clouds form. But I think, you know, just as Todd was showing, the structures in these are coherent across this scale, because we see that they occupy essentially the same velocity window across this 400 parsec scale. And we see it in all of these different phases. And so I think what that tells us is that they do have to have some sort of common origin. Now, I think in the case of this absorber, you know, this, I believe, is consistent with, you know, what you might see piercing a galactic wind. We know that these galaxies drive out massive outflows. And so maybe this is gas that's precipitating out of this outflow, where you're seeing sort of a warmer, more volume filling phase in O6, and you're seeing this sort of maybe cooler, perhaps cooler, or certainly, you know, less smooth structure in these lower ions. But I think that that, you know, the simulations need to be able to reproduce things on smaller than 400 parsec scale if we want to be able to compare to this kind of data and the richness of data that do exist for CGM observations. So I think this is sort of, you know, similar to what Todd was saying, but now seeing this exists not just at the Milky Way and at lower redshifts, but also in the high redshift universe. So
maybe I can add a couple of words again. Let me echo Gwen. For observationally, I don't think it makes a lot of sense to distinguish between cloudy and misty. You can talk about cloud size, and let me actually try to show, if I may, one actual example of a cloud, okay, which is entrained in the in a galactic wind. If you can see my screen. So this happens to be a sideline which is penetrating through the Fermi bubble, and it's around 30 degree galactic latitude. It has a lot of excess X-ray and gamma ray along the sideline. So we know there's a lot of hot gas. And along the gas, along the sideline, we also detect a lot of cool gas detected in carbon 2, silicon 2, silicon 3, or even warmer gas, carbon 4. This is one of the few sidelines where you actually have 21 centimeter emission detected along the sideline. What we did actually to see how big the gas cloud is, we did a very large GBT mapping around the cloud. And actually we found that the typical size of such clouds are around hundreds of parsec, modulo beam smearing here, okay? That I still have to do. And what another interesting thing along the sideline was that not only we found that object, we also found some other companion clouds, which also have similar kinematic velocity, but and similar size, so hundreds of parsec scale, which are kind of spread around the same cloud. So this might be a sort of an example of where the cloud is getting shattered by the hot galactic wind. So it raises a question of how long can they even survive? And you see similar things in the CGM where, you know, a cool gas cloud after a few mega years might just disappear. Do you call it misty or cloudy? Is again, depends, I guess, on more physics than observation.
Thank you. So I see a couple hands up, and assuming that they pertain to this discussion, I saw Peng's hand first. So Peng, do you have something relevant to say?
Yes. So although I'm a theorist, I'm going to propose a very observational definition for cloudy or misty, which is just that if you're taking a column density, say in an absorption spectra, and you intersect many clouds, say tens or hundreds, you know, at a level where something like the central limit theorem will kick in, then that's misty. Whereas if you intersect of order one or two, there is a cloud, then I would call it cloudy.
And so are you defining a cloud for an observer who just has a single, you know, one-dimensional line of sight? Are you defining a cloud as like a component?
So I would say, so suppose you observe a large Doppler parameter if that's internal turbulence for a single, you know, that if that's true turbulence, I would define that as a single cloud. If you actually had infinite resolution and it breaks up into lots of small things, then I would sort of define that as a mist. So it's kind of relevant to what Todd was talking about. So, you know, something where you have a very high area covering fraction, but a low volume filling fraction, I would call that a mist. So that's a straw man that people can kick around.
Thank you for that. And then I see another hand, Norbert, and then I'm going to get back to the panel, especially want to hear from Sanch. But Norbert, do you have something to add to this?
Yeah. I was actually wondering how much this discussion could be informed by the observations that we have in the course of clusters of galaxies, groups, and giant elliptical galaxies, where we actually see some of these multiphase cool and cold gas in emission. So in these systems, we see CO emitting cold clouds that are usually co-spatial with warmer C2 emitting 100 Kelvin-ish more diffuse gas or 1000 Kelvin phase. And these are usually co-spatial with H alpha filaments. And these are co-spatial with cooling X-ray emitting gas. So my picture of this is that it is gas clouds within gas phases, within gas phases.
Sanch, I see you nodding your head. Did you have anything you wanted to add to this?
No, I totally agree with the idea that although we have a sight line and we do not have a sort of a full view of what's going on, we do have a long line of sight. So it's kind of does tell us something about the volume filling. And I agree with Peng that we could probably do that, put that as number of components over a probably velocity spread could be something close to a mist versus a cloud. It's kind of sometimes hard to say if they are co-spatial. In my mind, I feel like even though we have a concept of mist, we have a sight line that goes through hundreds of kiloparsecs. So the idea of a mist is co-spatial, but sometimes it's very difficult for us to really realize that whether we are seeing stuff in front of the galaxy or behind or somewhere in the middle. So now I feel like I'm under a little bit of pressure because people have shown such wonderful data about a multiple components showing up on different sidelines. So I want to also show something which might not be related at all, but just for, to add to the discussion. So I want to share a sideline from the survey cost burst, which is led by Tim. So these are sidelines to the CGM of star bursting galaxies. So of course, because of that, we are kind of very interested in seeing what's going on in a starburst. There are not that many in starburst galaxy with a background quasar in the nearby universe. So data is sparse, but again, here we do see that, since everybody knows absorption spectra, I don't wanna discuss a whole lot what they're just different species here, but all I'm just trying to show that here I see three different components showing up in different transitions. Oxygen 6 is seen in all the on the different components, but other transitions sort of fade out. So you can see that a warmer component and a sort of intermediate component, a cooler component. In my mind, there is no reason that this has to be exactly co-spatial. It could be different parts of the outflow, which is what I think. So in this approach, I think it's more like a different clouds versus like a mist that completely sort of covers the galaxy. But I would like to hear what people have been sort of seeing in their data and simulations.
Thanks. Sanj. I think that actually leads nicely into what I want to talk about next. But first, I want to call on Joel and then Mary, who both have their hands up, who sound like they want to say something about this discussion. Joel, go ahead.
Okay. So, you know, an exercise I did, and I think that Stocky and friends also did something similar with different data sets, is that you can look at, say, the typical cloud that one finds along a line of sight through a halo, and you can assume pressure equilibrium, and then you get a size. And then you can estimate how many of these clouds you need along a line of sight, what the size is. You can also do it by noticing that there are multiple components, and then about 10% of your cases, you don't see absorption lines. And that leads to approximately the same number of components along the line of sight, about 2.2 to 2.4. And you know what the columns are. And so once again, you can estimate the number of clouds and the size of clouds. The size of a cloud is 1 to 200 parsecs, and you have about of order a million in the halo. And one of the other thing, this is a cloud that one is fitting for, but you have associations of clouds, as you can, just because you have a cloud in, say, one of the high velocity cloud streams around the Milky Way, doesn't mean you don't have lots of others nearby. And so, that accumulation is, or that association is larger, about an order of magnitude larger. The other thing I just wanted to mention, because it hadn't gotten mentioned, is that if you take a cloud and let it fall through the halo, calculate what the momentum and energy flux onto the cloud is from ram pressure, it's comparable, if not greater, than the energy coming in from photoionization. And Gray and company, several years back, asked the question, if this goes into turbulence, the turbulence decays into heat, how does it affect the ionization structure of the clouds? And it's a rather interesting result. It's an important new heating mechanism that would naturally occur as these clouds fall. It leads to a broader range of ionization states than you might get just from photoionization. It's a paper worth looking over and deciding whether or not it's a piece of physics that should be included in to the analysis of these data. Okay, that was it.
Thanks, Joel. Mary?
Yeah, I'll try to be brief, but if you're considering the densest gas in the halo to fall under this criteria of representing the shattering or the clumping, then you can look to the high resolution H1 observations of HVCs in our halo, right? Because what you see is these large extended structures. These are single dish observations. When you do the points of ELA at these, you're largely, you do see clumping, but you're resolving out the vast majority of the emission as well, indicating you have a clumpy cloud, but it's very clearly in this extended envelope of neutral hydrogen emission. So you're not breaking it up into, oh, look, it's all like little shattered clouds. It's just part of one giant complex, which does have structure within it.
Yeah, thank you. And that actually, that's really, that leads to this other question, and there are various themes of questions that are along the lines of what Todd said early on in his talk is, are observers getting behind by not emphasizing the details of their data, right? And so what the question I wanna pose to the panel is, you know, how can we do better at emphasizing, you know, the details of our data while not getting kind of bogged down so much in the limitations, but how can we be honest about the limitations? And in along those lines, on the Slack, there's various Slack threads. I think Kirill Chernyshov made a really interesting comment about Is it possible to do profile analyses of lower resolution data that actually include all the possibilities that are made apparent by the high resolution data? Like, could you do this in a kind of statistical way that doesn't lead to infinite solutions? And that kind of blew my mind. But then, you know, down in the discussion list, people are talking about the kind of required resolution that you need to actually resolve the component structure. And X made a comment that 1 kilometer per second is overkill, maybe 2.5 kilometer per second is enough. So I'm interested from our panel of expert observers, you know, what do you think about the data, the limitations of the data, all this information?
Well, I guess I'll go ahead and make a quick comment. The resolution you require, of course, depends on what you're looking at. So if you're looking at molecular gas, which you can see in absorption, quite a few different molecules, that probably does require exquisite resolution. And I've done quite a bit of work with Ed Jenkins on carbon-1 over the years in the Milky Way. Carbon-1 also benefits from very good resolution. So it really depends on what you're doing. Now, maybe if you're looking at the hot gas, maybe for X-ray spectroscopy, you don't need it. And it's just smooth volume filling stuff. But that's why I wanted to be sure to show that oxygen 6 at the end. One might assume that that should be smooth at high resolution, and yet it resolves. And so maybe we should be careful about not making too many assumptions. I ran out of time, but it's interesting that the H1 lines in that same E140H spectrum do not resolve into more components at the higher resolution. They stay smooth. It's just the metals that seem to be showing more and more component structure. So that's a quick comment on resolution. And so, you know, what I'm interested in, because it's the only future I have, is what you can do from the ground. Because I mean, they're trying to keep Hubble going for a long time, but you know, things are delicate up there. They're old instruments, and especially the UV spectrographs have a lot of problems. So can ground-based instruments start to move toward higher spectral resolution? I mean, I'm sure you can. I don't know how expensive it is, or you know, which shell spectrographs can do that, but that's one way to go forward, is to get better spectral resolution from the ground.
I'm interested to hear from, it sounds like Rongmon wants to say something, and I'm also interested to hear from Gwen on this issue too, especially the idea of, you know, emphasizing what we're missing from the lack of resolution or something. Okay, anyway.
Let me give a different perspective. I think we're asking the wrong people, because we can stare at millions of quasar spectra with best signal to noise. We don't actually know how many clouds there actually is on the sky. We don't know where they are along the line of sight, period. We will not know. We happen to be living in an age where we have fantastic simulations now, be it the Choya simulation, the Foggy simulation, the Fire simulation, which are now focusing on extremely high resolution CGM simulations, right? We should be asking the simulators to do this simple experiment, you know, have a set of different distribution of clouds or whatnot, where they are, create X number of spectra with different resolution and see how it stacks up. Like, we should be asking a question like, given, let's say, a cloud mass and a halo mass, what is the probability that you will have spatial and kinematic coherence of H1 and O6, et cetera? So we'd probably need to address this question in that direction.
So you're talking about idealized simulations, Rongmon, right?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah,
that is a big step right now.
Yeah, and I don't know that anybody's done a study of synthetic spectroscopy through idealized simulations, which would be very exciting.
Yeah. So I'll jump in here. I agree that a lot can be learned by looking into these simulations, but I would caution against the idea that that's the only way we can learn something about this. Because while I agree that we don't know, you know, what exactly is hidden underneath, you know, the finite resolution of our data and so forth, these data do represent what exists in the real universe, and none of the simulations do yet, which I don't think is an insult in the slightest to the theorists. I think we're learning quite a lot from these simulations. But at the end of the day, I think we have to do both. In terms of what's missing in the data, I won't in any way claim that the, you know, the data that I have are perfect and that there's nothing underneath underneath them that's hidden. But I think when we look very carefully into the structure of this mist or clouds or whatever we want to call them in the high redshift universe, we see that there are extremely small structures, but they are extraordinarily well aligned across multiple ionization stages. So we see the same structure in the low ion phases as we see in the higher ion phases. And it's only when we get up to oxygen six that we see a very, very different structure. These are aligned within a, you know, like within a few kilometers per second, probably more precisely across these different phases. They, of course, change in their column density ratios by an enormous amount. So we see strong differences in ionization phase over changes of a handful of kilometers, tens of kilometers per second. So we see enormous complexity in the CGM, but I don't understand how you would possibly have, you know, a cloud or some structure, a filament or something like this, that's separated or stretched over 100 kiloparsecs, where you see that level of alignment in velocity. And also you see a consistent velocity width to the profile that's consistent with some measure of temperature and turbulence, even when measured across a variety of ion phases that have different masses. So you can actually try and disentangle that idea. So in some sense, the data are more complicated, but in other sense, they may be simpler. They may be pointing to this relatively simple picture still, even if they're complex. So I think that that's important. And I should say that this is all consistent also with, extremely careful modeling that has been done by several groups now. I really want to highlight Fari's very sort of in my view, some of the first look at this in CGM style data. His 2019 paper is really beautiful about looking at the multi-component structure and the abundances and densities that you can pull out by analyzing each of these components separately. And I think that kind of work is going to be really important to really pull out what we can from these data. But I agree that, you know, at cost resolution, one has to be careful. You can find increasing line widths as a function of ionization potential. This is something that we're seeing in cubs. I'd be happy to talk more about at some point. This is work that's being led by Tom Cooper at Carnegie, as well as Fari Zahedi at Carnegie. I think the great thing is I think we have these amazing data, and they really are telling us critical information about the structure of gas within the circumgalactic medium and what that tells us about galaxy evolution. And so, you know, I think this is a great opportunity to really try and confront what's seen in simulations. Like, we know that even the best simulations aren't yet converging, right? So these very, very high resolution simulations are not yet converged in terms of the structure of the CGM. If they run it at twice the resolution, they see smaller clouds still. And I believe that's a true statement across all simulations, but please correct me if I'm wrong about someone's work. I think we still both have a lot of pushing to do in terms of the theoretical community as well as the observational community.
So speaking of Fari, whose hand is up, Fari, you want to unmute and say something to add to this?
Oh, yeah. Thanks, Gwen. So just to echo Gwen's point, I think there is definitely a room where we as observers can make progress. It's not all hopeless, even if we are in some ways falling a little behind the theorists. I think some of the ways that we can make progress in the future, for instance, is to move beyond just this single characterization of, you know, just a cloud size and try to, you know, with careful modeling, move one step further and try to say, try to derive some kind of a distribution of cloud sizes from our observation. This is, of course, not easy, as those who have done, you know, careful modeling of those profiles can attest. But, even if you just try to do a simple component decomposition of your absorption profiles and try to model them carefully, not just by matching line widths, but also by matching, not just by matching velocity centroids, but also matching the line widths, you can already clearly see that clouds that you used to think are kiloparsec across already shrinks to 100 parsec scales. And also, if you do this, your modeling, you see that non-negligible probability of your clouds are on tens of parsec scales or smaller. This also pertains to Peng's point earlier. We don't know yet if we have any smaller clouds in a parsec scales cloud, perhaps. And if so, what that means in terms of this clouds versus mist paradigm. But I think one of the best ways forward in terms of this discussion is to try to figure out observationally what is this distribution of cloud sizes in the CGM.
Thank you. Yeah, and I think one of the things that Todd and others showed slides, you know, maybe this will get the theorists to appreciate that, you know, the richness of the data themselves. And so, you know, I think generally observers do report this, but, you know, how do we get through the theorists that there's more than just those bulk column densities? Maybe today we've made some headway on that. Okay, so the last subject I want to make sure we address, because this is one of the top rated comments from last week, which we punted to this week. And then a few people have mentioned it, including Todd and Greg Bryan on the Slack channel, is this idea, and Joel Bregman just now, this idea of pressure equilibrium. And just that the simple kind of bulk models that you do with photoionization and thermal equilibrium, you know, yield orders of magnitude off from the kind of low pressures or high pressures that you need in the very cold clouds. The cold clouds are underpressurized, that is, by a lot. Even when you do the detailed modeling, like Carl Haselmeier, Fari Zahidi has done, and Samir, it sounds like, has also done, I think you still get, you know, this mismatch that things don't look like they're in pressure equilibrium with the hot phase. So I just want to get people on the panel to talk about this. Do we favor solutions that actually just add in another thermal phase, or do we favor, you know, non-thermal solutions? I'd love to get some opinions on this.
Well, I'll start. I guess I'm feeling kind of bad that I might have derailed this panel with the misty versus cloudy question. But, you know, it's really Max and Peng's fault because they wrote the paper with that title. So I'll just pass blame because that's what we do in the US these days. But what I'm trying to learn is, are there ways that, or even if there are observations that we haven't done, are there ways that we can discriminate between one theoretical possibility and another? And we, you know, we've been hearing about this precipitation or cold clouds that form in situ, or that, you know, what are the signatures of these different interesting physical processes? Can we find a way to make progress on understanding the circumgalactic gas? So I don't know the answers, but I hope I made at least a somewhat of a case for observations having a lot of information that might help out. But maybe, I don't know, it might be years away. The theorists will have to comment on, you know, how realistic an idealized simulation is for comparison to observations or something like that. But that's what I hope we're all driving toward ultimately.
So is there anybody else on the panel that wants to comment on pressure equilibrium in particular? Otherwise, I'm going to go to the hands.
Okay. I think the only thing that I'll say is that, you know, it is often the case that it's challenging to make real detailed measurements of the hot phase as well as a cooler phase within the same halo. Like, this is perhaps possible in, you know, X-ray emitting places that have X-ray emitting gas that also have a probe of cooler gas in some way. It's certainly not really possible at high Z, but we do see this O6 that appears to be somewhat more volume filling, but it would be very challenging to say much about that oxygen 6 because it's not detected in a lot of, you know, in a lot of other gas. And so I think it's hard to understand whether that could be an equilibrium, because understanding what the actual density and temperature of that oxygen 6 is, I think would be a challenging feat basically for the data. But I do think it's an interesting point.
So I'm going to call on Jonathan Stern, whose hand has been up, and I think I know that he has something valuable to add to this. Jonathan. Oh, we can't hear you though. Try taking off your headphones. We can't hear you. Talking into your computer or something. Cannot hear you at all. All right, Jonathan is going to sort out his audio issues, and I'm going to go to Freyka, who has her hand up. Freyka?
Yes, I hope you can hear me. I just wanted to say that we have some, in our simulations, which include magnetic fields, we find that so I compared the ones that had no magnetic fields to those that did, and the pressure is much smoother in the ones that does, and it tends to be the cool gas that has the highest magnetic pressure, so that brings them back into equilibrium. Obviously we don't resolve parsec scales and stuff, but this is what we find on sort of kiloparsec scales and beyond in our cosmological simulations.
Thank you. Yeah, it's been my impression from some of the recent literature, and we'll hear more about non-thermal processes next week, that, you know, the simulations at least favor the non-thermal solutions for getting to pressure balance in the circumgalactic medium, but I'm not so sure about the observations. All right, Jonathan, sounds like your sound is back.
Yes, can you hear me now? Good, excellent, sorry about that. Yeah, so three comments on pressure equilibrium. So one, yes, we should also always take into account the fact that possibly the high ions come off for larger scales than the low ions, okay? And therefore they come from regions where the pressures are lower. And one way we can see evidence for this is if we look at the distribution, the Coulomb versus impact parameter of different ions, they look very different between O6 and the low ions. Okay, so the low ions, the O6 kind of rises very quickly at the virial radius and then flattens out. The low ions kind of rise all the way inward. So if you deproject this, you see directly that there's a lot of O6 coming from larger scales than the low ions. Okay, so that's kind of one direct way to say that the O6 has to come from a region where the gas has a lower pressure. That's the first comment. Second comment is we see huge velocities in these absorbers. Okay, so that's either turbulence or some bulk motions. Okay, and therefore the pressure of this, the ramp pressure or the turbulent pressure, must be taken into account when we're doing thermal equilibrium. If you look at be included in the equilibrium of the pressures, right? You have this ramp pressure. If you see, you know, 60 kilometers per second turbulence, then you expect comparable variances in the thermal pressure, okay? If you convert that thermal pressure. That's the second. And the third comment I have is, in low mass halos, I don't think there's any kind of uniform hot gas which enforces pressure equilibrium, okay? The cooling times are very short. In low mass halos, it's very hard to avoid this. And then there's nothing enforcing pressure equilibrium. Actually, also in simulations, we see huge ranges of a huge range of pressures in the CGM, because we don't really expect even pressure equilibrium. We see this in fire. We see there's a paper by Raymond Simons and Foggy about this. Okay, so this kind of we want, you know, this comparison to pressure equilibrium is a good thing to do because it's kind of the zero order model, but we have to kind of keep in mind that there's lots of caveats and lots of things we don't expect, even without assuming what smart people think about, like magnetic fields and the cosmic rays. So even before that, it's problematic. Yeah.
Thank you, Jonathan. Okay, so so we're getting to the hour. It's 9:59. I want to allow one more person near. You've had your hand up, so I'll let you talk about pressure equilibrium. Assuming those of you who have your hands up that I haven't been able to get to, please go to the Slack. This is where a lot of asynchronous discussion is going to happen. So let's wrap up with a comment from Nir, and then anything a panelist might have to say about pressure equilibrium, and then also all head over to the Slack for this animated discussion. We'll have more discussion time all week long.
Hi, thanks. Thanks so much. This is really great. So I guess one question and then one comment. I was wondering whether or what the evidence was or what we think about pressure equilibrium versus non-equilibrium at high redshift, say redshift, you know, 2 or so. And, you know, obviously I think a lot about inflowing cold streams at those redshifts, and I guess we'll hear more about that during week six. But I will make one comment that, at least insofar as our studies of cold inflowing streams go, what we do find is since the streams are flowing at inflowing at such supersonic speeds compared to their own sound speed, you'll often find that locally the streams are outside of pressure equilibrium at a given halocentric distance, because they just haven't managed to yet, a given Lagrangian fluid element has not yet managed to regain the pressure balance. So it looks as though it has lower pressure just because it came from a lower pressure medium and it hasn't yet regained its pressure balance. So that might also be an issue that we have to account for, in addition to all the non-thermal components, et cetera, just very supersonic motions, and it takes time to regain pressure balance.
Huh. And so, Gwen, did you have anything to add about high redshift in particular? I know you're the highest redshift CGM observer I know.
Well, I think the one thing I can comment is that we can measure pretty clearly, actually, the temperature and internal non-thermal broadening of absorption lines, individual structures, maybe these mist components that Peng is talking about. And so we can say something in detail about the internal motions of atoms and ions within these structures. And then we can also say something about at least, the projected bulk flow motions of these particles through the halo. I don't think we can say what else is in the halo at high redshift. I think this is one of the really big challenges. Certainly X-ray telescopes are not yet capable of telling us if there's a hot gas there. And I think that would be very interesting, of course, to many of the simulators as well as the observers. But I do think that there's a lot left on the table in terms of understanding this, like, what is driving the internal motions inside these clouds, as well as the temperatures that we measure, which shows a lot of actually intermediate temperature gas that should cool extraordinarily quickly. I think there is some interesting stuff there. And I will point people towards the turbulence channel, which we're talking about some of these topics on. So if people are interested, come join us on the turbulence Slack channel. So.
Yes, and non-thermal week, next week, we'll have a lot of time to feature that conversation and talk more about turbulence. Okay, it is now 10:03. I've run wildly over time, but I want to thank in particular our keynote speaker, Todd Tripp, and our expert panel. Give everybody a round of applause again. Use your emojis. Thank you so much for making this so interactive. Please head to the Slack for asynchronous discussion. Tomorrow we have 4 tutorials with ample time for discussion after each, in case you want to dive into this more. I know that this conversation will be ongoing all week. I really hope so. So in the meantime, everybody have a great day and see you tomorrow morning.
Bye.